Hello, David Zaritsky for the Bond Experience. Welcome back. Now, you've probably seen by now a few videos that I've put around my time in Jamaica. Certainly, the tour of GoldenEye, probably seen that. You may have seen me singing, I'll put that in big quotes, at Laughing Waters from Dr. No, of course, right? I had to. I had to break into the mango tree. And the world will never be the same. Yeah. And then, of course, the danger, the excitement, the destruction and mayhem of Kananga's Croc Farm in Falmouth, Jamaica. Yes, these have been some great points. Today is a bit of a bolus dose. Yes, buckle up because we're going to take you on an amazing tour of James Bond's Jamaica, thanks to the Jamaica Tourist Board. Now, this is a group that is so passionate about Jamaica. I mean, look at their heartbeat of the world. I mean, that is their mantra, that Jamaica is the heartbeat of the world. And I'm hard to argue that because there is so much love and appreciation and passion around Jamaica that it does. It feels like that if the rest of the world is this mind and body, then the heartbeat, the very thing that keeps it going, why not Jamaica? And I'm sold. I'd like to think that they maybe have adopted me as an honorary Jamaican. What would the world come to? I'm just dreaming. But we've got to talk about this because this is something that it was a day-long adventure where we explore some of the locations of not just Dr. No, but Live and Let Die. It's hard to fathom that three Bond movies, no less than three Bond movies, have been filmed in Jamaica. So it's a little bit of a bookend. You have Dr. No and you have No Time to Die. But somewhere in the middle, you have Live and Let Die. And the people that brought me on this tour, Carrie and Ziggy, are experts. One of them actually worked on No Time to Die, and the other one just is the heartbeat of the Jamaica's Tourist Board, and that's Carrie. And so you'll hear from both of them today in this video. Our first stop is going to be from Live and Let Die. It is the cliff and scene that you see good old Roger flying in, smoking a cigar on his hang glider. Looks like it's nighttime. Here's that specific location. Okay, we are beginning our Bond tour at a very auspicious place, but I need to introduce you to our tour guide of the day. Carrie, thank you so much for doing this.
Yeah, man, thanks for coming.
It's our pleasure, and you are from the Jamaican Tourist Board.
Yes, I am. I've been working with them for over 24 years now, so I have a little bit of experience.
Have you always lived in Jamaica?
Yes.
And I heard and researched that you have backpacked, you've climbed mountains, you're an adventurer like James Bond.
No. I'm an adventurer, but just not like James Bond.
See, you're steeped in reality, and I'm in denial because I'm playing James Bond and you're the real guy.
Well, you see, James Bond, he goes after spies and all that kind of stuff.
Yes.
I just do it for fun. But he does it for work.
You know what? That is a huge difference. All right, where are we right now?
Right now we're at rear end of a battle site, and this location was used as a cliffs where Roger Moore hang glided onto Kananga's hideout.
And this thing is steeped in history. I think people watch that scene and they go, "Oh, what a pretty cliff." But this has a lot of history to it.
Yes, rear end of a battle site, if you're looking out at the sea, that's where the British came in 1965, beat up the Spanish, and that's why we no longer talk Spanish and we talk English now.
So it's their fault.
Yes.
So, I mean, do you have any idea why they picked this particular place? I mean, obviously it's absolutely beautiful, but.
All right, I think the expedition was led by, I think it's General Penn and another guy called Venables. And these guys were sent in the Caribbean by Oliver Cromwell, who was the British ruler at the time. So they went to Panama to try and beat up the Spanish in Panama, but they were beaten up. So on their way back to Britain, they were fretting because Oliver Cromwell, if you sneeze too hard, he cuts off your head. So these guys are fretting that, boy, if we go back, they're going to cut off our heads. But there were some sailors in their crew that knew about Jamaica, and it was a Spanish colony, and it was unprotected. So they say, let's go try this. And the rest is history. They came here, the group split into one group went to the south coast, who marched across Ireland to come behind the Spanish. So while they and their ships were at the front here, and the Spanish were concentrating on them, the group snuck in the back, and they ambushed them, and the rest is history.
It makes the James Bond history almost anemic compared to the military history.
Yeah. Yes, yes, it's very intriguing. There was a Spanish general here at the time called General Isasi. And he was the one who was, he actually had like a police force. He didn't have a military force. Right. Because the Spaniards used Jamaica as a, there was no gold. They didn't find any gold here. And you know they're interested in gold. Mm. So they used Jamaica as a kind of supply post. So it was just farmers here. So General Isasi had probably like about 100 men just to police. I doubt it was so much to police, to make sure that peace was kept here amongst the people who are living here. So when the British came, they couldn't resist the British.
Right.
So he had some Spanish, some African slaves called Maroons, who the Maroons associated a lot with the native people, the Taínos, so they knew where a lot of caves were.
Hmm.
So the Maroons took the general and some of his soldiers to the Green Grotto Caves, which is another James Bond location.
Yes.
So they took them to the Green Grotto Caves, and they stayed there for about 3 months hoping to get reinforcements from Cuba to beat back up the British. But the reinforcements didn't come, so eventually they left Jamaica at a place called Runaway Bay. Yeah.
Okay, let's get a look then in more detail at the cliffs themselves and really see Roger Moore, cigar in mouth, kicks that poor guy off. How terrible. Let's take a look. Keeping with the whole theme of live and let die, we went to another location to see where many of the parts and pieces, including Baron Samedi and some of the introductions of him, came into play. But you're going to hear from their resident Bond expert, who, by the way, has a personality all to himself. Let's explore.
You can see Roger Moore entering the bell desk, coming through here the lobby and going to that room on the side that at the time used to be the gift shop, but now is actually our.
All right, so I'm here with my new friend Pierre, and Pierre, you've been here for a bit, haven't you?
Yes, I've been the general manager here at Couple Sans Souci for the last 22 years. I had a previous also employment before that. I was in charge of the entire food and beverage operation of the hotel. So in total, I've been here almost 25 years.
Oh my gosh, so you're going to be our Bond guide for the day.
Okay, for the entire day?
For the morning, for this, okay, for this location. Okay. We're actually standing in a scene from Live and Let Die, right?
Exactly, yes. This is the lobby of the resort. It's a very unique lobby. And we have kept, the original design of the lobby all this time. You know, the owners, the new owners, that's Couples Resort, Mr. Lee and Jane Issa. You know, they made sure that they want to keep the originality of the design. of the lobby. As you can see, he has kind of a shape that of a turn, you know, it's turning, and those huge posts in the middle, you know. So, and of course, the roof is Wallaba shingles, you know. Wow. Originally, actually, it was cedar shingles, but they moved back to the Wallaba shingle, a little more stronger, but wooden shingles, you know.
Fantastic.
So, as I said, this resort has been, you know, operating in the 50s and 60s. And of course, at the beginning, it was a hippie hotel called Sans Souci and Spa, because we have one of the most famous spa in the region here, with a mineral spring and mineral pool and so forth. And of course, had the privilege to host two of the first movies of the James Bond series, you know. The first one was with Dr. No, and you will see some of the cottages that were used. And the second one, with a little more into it, was Live and Let Die, you know, with Roger Moore, to the point where we actually have a Roger Moore suite here at Sans Souci, because Roger spent quite a bit of time here when he filmed the movie, okay?
Fantastic.
So, yeah.
Thank you.
The lobby, right away, you are welcomed by this majestic ocean view, okay? So that's the, you know, one of the or you call it, point of the entrance of the hotel.
Beautiful.
The lobby, the bell desk, with that, actually that stand and everything here, it was actually part of one of the shuttles, so of Roger Moore coming into the resort, okay?
That same stand?
Yeah, well, he has been rebuilt a few times, but but it kind of a similar feel, you know?
I love it.
That kind of colonial feel that, you know, that the resort had, and you can take, you know, filming of actually architectural of that, in particular the lobby, you know? This is the room where the gift shop used to be.
This is where he bought the tarot card.
Right, exactly. So you can enter. This is used to be the gift shop of the hotel. Now it is our computer room, our games room, and our photo desk. Mm-hmm. You know.
That's fantastic. So the window, actually, you know what? If you swing over here. The window over here is where you would have seen it from the outside.
Yes, the original windows of that gift shop that was in the Live and Let Die movie.
Oh my gosh, look at this. Hold on a second.
You find a car too.
Look at this. Still here after all these years.
Oh, my That's gosh. A magic, eh?
The Queen of Cups. This is so magical here. My gosh, this is the card that he was given when he was here.
Yes, yes.
That's fantastic. You know what? Let's get some outside shots of this,
okay,
too.
Okay.
So Roger would have actually come in from over here, and then you would have seen the tarot card pictures. We'll show a shy shot of that. And why? Because he was investigating this little gift that he gets at breakfast, which we know was from somebody trying to give him a warning. No warning here. This place is beautiful.
We're around here, especially this one and this one. Those were the cottages, but you know, a lot of new things have been added to it.
But this was the place where it would have been.
Yes, yes. This is the place where he was.
Thank you. Watch that step.
So. The architecture of the cottages have changed, you know. The entrance used to be on this side, now it's on that side, same of that one. But this is a cottage that we sell to the guests.
Oh.
It's our hibiscus cottage.
Hmm.
You know, he has an incredible view. He has his own jacuzzi.
This is amazing. You could see why they picked this area for the film. I mean, absolutely amazing.
Staff who live there right now. But this is area that's where the cottages were used for the Dr. No movie.
Wonderful. We are now heading to the area. It is their spa area, but it is where Baron Samdi did his voodoo dance. Prepare yourselves. So this would have been the tower that you see in the film.
In the background, yes. Yeah. And this is the terrace that they use for the voodoo dancing. You know, you have with the fires and the people dancing to call for the voodoo. You know, so this entire area was used for that. At the time, it was no gazebo. It was a full area. And of course, this tower is actually a symbol of Couple Sans Souci. It's a tower that has an elevator, so it can bring us back up to the top.
Wow. You know?
So that's very unique. You're not going to see something like this anywhere else, you know? So coming down, this is all the various gazebo for the spa. And I'm going to show you the mineral springs.
This has a very live and let die vibe to it. Oh, wow. Yes, I remember this extremely well.
So this is a mineral spring. We have several one on properties. Actually, this entire area of the property is sitting on the mineral springs. And we have, I will show you a grotto where people can actually swim in the spring. And this water, we had a turtle who used to live in this grotto.
Oh my gosh.
For over 50 years.
What?
Yes, it's a turtle that was found on the beach by the fisherman when Hurricane Charlene passed. So she got hurt. The fisherman put her in this grotto. You know, with a mineral water, she was able to heal.
Oh my gosh.
And they decided to keep her there, and it was a feature of the hotel for many, many years. Here we have a plaque that speaks about the turtle.
Poor Charlie, we knew him well.
Well, she died over 10 years ago. But I was here for a long time, so we used to feed her twice a day.
So Pierre, this alley right here might have been in the movie?
Yes, I think so. It was part of the entire broadcast of here at Sans Souci. So this alley was filmed during that particular movie. And I'm...
So Pierre, right up here, this is the Roger Moore penthouse?
Yes. So... Whoop, let's come out of this one. Right. So on top you had Roger Moore, and on the bottom you have Ursula Andress.
That's so exactly that's where Roger Moore likes to be.
Right.
Sorry. Pierre's like, I got nothing.
So definitely, he could have oversee her.
Sure.
You know, from his top penthouse, and we still have the Roger Moore penthouse. The penthouse is a fabulous area up there. So definitely you'll see this in the movies, you know?
Okay, simple place, but it's a white river. This is the place that James Bond and, of course, Ursula Andress and Quirrell have to hide underneath the water with reeds. It's right over there under the bushes, and the water looks exactly the same. It's kind of that greenish hue that you saw in the movie itself. So it's fascinating. We'll take a quick look. Yep, let me just do a little bit of B-roll. Now, Laughing Waters wasn't the only falls that were used in Jamaica. Right next door, practically right next door to it, is Dunn's River Falls, certainly more of a tourist attraction, much larger and not private. But we have our own tour and tour guide to show us those moments from Dunn River Falls. Let's head over there.
Okay.
Okay, so we are at world famous Duns River Falls. These are so prolific that you can actually see it from the ocean when cruise ships come in. This is where Bond and Honey Rider and Coral would have hid underneath trees and bushes. It's been eroded by hurricanes, but you can still see the magnificence of the falls. We're gonna go up a little bit higher where you saw Bond and Honey talking about Honey's life, and you'll see that background. Not everything was filmed here though, and we're gonna visit that shortly, but let's see the rest of Duns River Falls. Okay, this is one of my highlights because, quite frankly, this is where Bond is kind of relaxing against a tree. You know, he's kind of cleaning his gun, got a little wet, and he's talking to Honey, and Honey's explaining, taken directly from the Ian Fleming book, all about the fact that she had to kill somebody, that she knows a lot about the encyclopedia. You know the scene. We're showing a clip of it real quick. This is what was in the background. So you had the little hideaway at the bottom, then you had this in the background. And the reason they chose this at the background, it is one of the most robust areas as far as the fall is concerned. They really wanted to show that this was paradise. And yet they were amongst something insidious, peril in paradise. That could have been the tagline of Dr. No, peril in paradise. But this is what was in the background with the beautiful flowers that still exist. I mean, these are the great, 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 great grandchildren of the flowers that were here, and all the beauty, all the inspiration still exists today. You can feel Dr. No. Okay, do you remember the time that Bond and Solitaire were together and they go down the little elevator shaft into the lair of Kananga, Mr. Big? And listen, they're running through the caves. Well, many of those caves were actual caves. It wasn't just on a studio. And this next visit, this next location is Green Grotto Caves, where they filmed a lot of those scenes. And there's even a part of it that was the inspiration for the set that was eventually Kananga's lair. Now, here's the really cool part. You're not allowed to film in here, all right? Typically, they're not allowed to film, but the Jamaican Tourist Board, they open a lot of doors. They're a pretty influential group. So they were able to have the Bond experience have some very rare footage that you're now going to see. Let's go check it out. Okay, the hat that I'm wearing and the hairnet says safety first, and they're actually quite comfortable. When you enter in here, they really do care about the visitors, but we are entering a very natural environment. It's a cave, and it's to be taken very seriously. You should also take it seriously because it's Kananga's, Mr. Big's hideout, his evil lair, and we're gonna see it all today. Hey, that's good. That's really good.
I'm a James Bond fan.
Clearly.
Sean Connery.
Is Sean Connery your favorite Bond?
Well, honestly, it's Roger Moore. But I like Sean Connery as well. I'm more of the old school Bond fan. Not the more recent one. Old school to me is more authentic. They do a great job in acting and everything. The presentation is amazing. Especially when it comes to Roger Moore, he's Mr. Smooth.
He is.
Sean Connery's like, I get to the point. I'm a person. But they had a run-through scene here with J.C. Moore and Roger Moore that ran through this area cave. Where on the left there was a door that they ran through.
Ah, the metal door.
Yes, so the metal door was on that end.
Oh, very cool.
They ran through all the way down into the Green Grotto Caves, where they shot the scenes of Dr. Kananga's lair. Mm-hmm.
Fantastic.
It is. Massive cave as well, 10 miles long. Please watch this back. The sensors will turn on as you go along. However, for the film though, the air wasn't this smooth. It was like more like loose rocks in this section, so they ran that side. We're gonna go around and come back on that end. So we're going in a circle.
Great.
Oh, you're delighted to see bats too. I'm sure you don't mind that.
Not at all. Some of our favorite friends are the bats.
Oh, for real?
Not so much.
We have only just 9 species. They don't eat people. I don't think they're considering it right now. It's only advice that you look at, then you have to have the mouths closed, but you already have the mouths covered, so it's all good. So this is where the final scene, or if you say, special effects, takes place.
Now, was this a combination of here and also back on a movie set as well, or
yes,
a little bit of both?
The only thing that puzzles me the most is that how did they get the equipment in this cave to do it?
They did it though.
Yeah, because that's in the 70s, you know, movie equipment was way bigger than today.
Yeah. Lot that time bigger.
It's expensive manure. You find that they're selling this as a manure in Jamaica. It's not going to go cheap.
Yeah, man. Very, very expensive.
So this is where Roger Moore's Bond and obviously Jane Seymour, they run through. And is this where they come?
You went straight through.
Ah, straight through. Okay. Yeah. Very nice.
I'll take you to where the door was in the movie that they ran through, the metallic door.
Lovely.
I'll take you there as well. Movie, I realized that when Roger Moore was in the cemetery and he fought that man, when he knocked on the tomb and he came down the elevator, that's the cave he came down into.
Oh, you're kidding.
He came down in that little cave.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
How amazing.
As I said, also amazing. The cemetery scene was done somewhere else, but the guy went to an elevator, ended up here.
Rosa, cemetery scene was done in
Rosa. Many respects,
sir. Here on the Rosa.
Okay, so over here to the left is where the metal door was?
Yes, right
here. Very nice. He's told me.
Floors. Floors go.
Floors go.
He pulled another one out of the bag.
I think he's got a repertoire, which is great.
Well, thank you.
If you should somehow get to see the photos that Jane Seymour took at Roger Moore.
Oh, the
was right here.
The press photos.
I think she was right here. She did that pose, like she did something like this.
Yes.
And Roger Moore was over here with his tuxedo. Something like this. I saw it on the internet, so this was the spot. Yeah.
You know by now that a lot of these locations can be hidden gems. I mean, but hiding on a golf course is one of the most famous shots and the most indelible moments with Jane Seymour and Roger Moore from Live and Let Die? That's not a question mark, that's fact. Let's go explore this and get ready for a bumpy ride to get there. Okay, yes, we're in a golf cart. This is not an Aston Martin. We're at Cinnamon Hill Golf Club. And why? Because this is where one of the scenes from Live and Let Die was filmed, and we're heading there. It's actually on the 15th hole. You gotta take a golf club, golf cart there. It's a little bumpy, but it's absolutely beautiful. We'll go check it out. Yeah.
And like that comes up from the hills. And we sometimes will push it away so you can see it. COVID thing going on right now. We have a little less staff than we did before.
Sure.
So this is pretty much it. When
we had exposed the vegetation at that time.
Yeah, no vegetation was there.
Right? Yeah.
But it's right here.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Right between. You can kind of see the way they
So went. Would they have walked down in there? Is that where they were walking basically? Or were they walking?
I'll leave that up to you, but
okay.
This was, like I say, this is untouched. This is what are we looking at? That'd be 45 years ago.
1973. Yeah.
73, right in there.
So, wow. I mean, it looks exactly no different. And there used to be someone left over,
supposedly a wooden cross or something, part of the graveyard. Have you heard about that or?
This is amazing.
And then. When we were just on the cart ride over, Carrie, I don't know exactly where the poppy field was.
Right.
Approximately, you know, we'll go over where.
I have an idea. Behind the greenhouse.
Yeah.
And I think the graveyard.
Back in there.
I think they featured some part of the graveyard too.
Okay. But
was behind the greenhouse. This year, they're behind the greenhouse.
All right, you hear that gurgling water in the background. Yeah, we're here. We're on the 15th hole, and this is the scene from Live and Let Die. We'll show an image from it over here in this corner, but that's it. Let's see if we can get it nice and close. I don't care about being wetted out because you want to see the waterfall, not me. But this is it. Now, there is a little bit of debate as far as why they wanted to film right here, but they were looking not for anything as large and as auspicious as Dunn's River Falls or even Laughing Water. They wanted something a little bit more subtle, this little hidden thing. And somebody said, you know, there's a waterfall right over here. Now, you're asking yourself, so was this a golf course? Yes. It was built in 1969, so it was only 5 years old. So this was the 15th hole, even when they filmed. Super cool. All right, so this is the greatest part of location hunting, is really speculating on some things, but you know, there's a subdivision you can basically see right there that was built. However, behind me is more than likely where the poppy fields were, where Bond and Solitaire are running through. There's explosions galore, and of course, they're being chased down. So these are not poppy fields, and it doesn't even look like it did. But that's the thing with location hunting, but it does have that vibe, so you could really do see it happening here. So next, we're heading to Rose Hall. Rose Hall is a place where another set of the poppy fields probably were, but anyway, Rose Hall is an edifice that we want to see anyway. It's part of the colonialism and a part of history, so we're going to go check that out. Welcome to Rose Hall. So right about now, you're saying to yourself, David, these are amazing locations. They're beautiful, and the stories behind them, boom, unbelievable. But you're standing in front of the No Time to Die display in your collection. You got some No Time to Die stuff, a la Jamaica. Where's the No Time to Die locations? Where are those in the video? Well, we're saving that. You know, certainly we want to show you those places and hear the stories, but we want to save it till much closer to the movie out of deference to a lot of people, but it'll keep some of the surprise. But that's all for now. And you know something, this right here, the Jamaican flag, the 007, they go hand in hand together. And you'll see that in the video that we took around the No Time to Die locations for sure. And by the way, I'm wearing a crew shirt. You could see the seaplane in the back that was used in the movie. This is a Jamaican crew shirt that were given to the crew, and it was bequeathed to me as a gift. So nice. And that goes back to Heart of the World and One Heart, One Love. I mean, there's so much love and appreciation. They're all huge Bond fans. Having Bond come back to Jamaica meant so much to them. Not just about revenue, and not just about jobs, and not just about being part of the James Bond lore and history, but bringing it back to their home, on their home ground. And you can see the richness of Jamaica and all it brings to the table. They were just waiting for it. So it's when you get there to Jamaica, Bond sings. You know, there are some places where they're like, yeah, 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 we had a Bond film. Not this place. They are proud. You know, they want to show it all off. And it shows. But we've got to make sure that we say goodbye to Carrie and Ziggy and thank them, because without them, the day wouldn't have happened. Let's go back to GoldenEye for a moment. Okay, the dimming light can only mean one thing. It's the end of the day. Gentlemen, Ziggy, Carrie, unbelievable. I cannot thank you enough. What an amazing day. And by the way, this was a tease. This was a preheat, because correct me if I'm wrong, but the Jamaican Tourist Board is going to be doing this for any James Bond fan, correct?
Yes, there's going to be a James Bond movie trail for anyone who wants to be a James Bond star. You can come and go to the locations and, yeah.
And eventually it's going to be all three movies?
Yes. Yes, it's going to be all three movies. Right now, because the last movie hasn't been released as yet, they are starting with the first two.
Yeah.
But as soon as it's released, it will be part of it.
It was amazing, and you two really created the most incredible thing. I call my channel the Bond Experience, but you created the Bond Experience. So Siggy, thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for coming to our country.
It was our pleasure. And by the way, people, as they get more and more comfortable with traveling, when lockdown ceases up, they have choices. And I have to tell you, it was amazing to come here for the location, but honestly, I implore everybody to come here for the people. The people are the most positive, happy individuals I've ever met. So thank you for being you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for saying that. We try. And with people coming like you coming here and making it known to the world that we are like this, it all goes to bed.
That's fantastic. All right. Well, this has been David Zaritsky for the Bond Experience. I need a shower. It's been a long day. We'll talk to you real soon. Take care. Thanks for watching this episode. If you want to be up on the latest from the Bond Experience, just click on this subscribe and subscribe to our channel. You're going to get all the latest and greatest information, plus some exclusive content. And by the way, speaking of content, here's something especially for you, just because we know you. Talk to you soon.